All right. So in my town, they call me La Jefa. That means the boss. I'm kind of like the mom of the beach. So I wouldn't call myself a local kite ace, but if that's what you guys want to call me, I'm fine with that. What we will be covering, what makes Cabarete special, the main beaches, Cabarete lifestyle and local culture, things to do when there is no wind, trip planning and logistics. So I started off as a professional race car driver, well, a street racer actually, and then I became a pro. So I've driven everything from rally cars to monster trucks, and you can see that's me back in my old life. I look nothing like that anymore because I haven't worn makeup in 10 years. I also have been on TV, and I've been sponsored by Ford. This is one of the cars that I designed and built for Ford. And up there in the top left-hand corner, that was me in one of the TV shows that I was in. I was kind of tired of it. I was supposed to be moving to Jamaica to take up rally racing, and as I was sponsored by Ford. But I couldn't get my dog into Jamaica because they're a rabies-free zone. So we started Googling dog-friendly places in the Caribbean, and we happened upon Cabarete. It was a direct flight from where I lived, so that's why we chose it. And we were like, oh, it has this thing called kiteboarding that we've never heard of. Maybe we'll enjoy kiteboarding, and that will be our new thing. Turns out it was my new thing. This is my tricks, and then this is my best trick, crashing. I learned how to kite when I was 34. I'm 43 now. When I moved to Cabarete, I came with my suitcase, my dog, and my vacuum cleaner because I knew there would be a lot of sand, and I never left. So I came there literally with one suitcase as a 34-year-old person. I sold all of my stuff via a power of attorney and on Skype. I've never seen my belongings ever again. So we're talking about this happened 10 years ago, and I've been here ever since. About 6 years into it, I decided I was going to buy a kite school. And this is my family. So that's me on the left. And then right next to me is Jose Luis Ciriaco. He was the first Dominican pro kitesurfer back in like the late 90s, early 2000s. And then that's the rest of our little family. His brother is on the right-hand side. He runs the restaurant at my kite school. And those are his two kids in the back. And those are our two kids in the front. So we're going to talk a little bit about Cabarete now and why I moved here. But the first thing I want us to do is get hyped, because Cabarete is a really hyped spot. It's really exciting. So I made this video. The video that I'm about to show you is of the Junior World Olympic gold medalist. I think that's how you say it. But anyways, I filmed this when he was 16. He's 20 now. So this is going to give you a little insight into why he ended up becoming the... Oh my gosh, I have to present it in order to play the video. Became the first Olympic gold medalist basically in the world, because they only did like the trials with the kids here. Okay, so as you can see, we're on the north coast of the Dominican Republic, and the Dominican Republic is part of Hispaniola. some people have asked me if we get hurricanes here, and we're in a hurricane hole. So you don't have to worry about hurricanes coming here. That's one of the really great things about Cabarete. We have five main beaches that you can kiteboard on. If you want to start on the right-hand side, we have the river mouth of La Boca. That's our flat water spot. The next one up is Cabarete Bay. And that's probably what you're going to find if you Google anything to do with kiteboarding in Cabarete, because that's the main part of town. The next part up is Bozo Beach and Punta Goleta. It's not a great place to kiteboard just because we have fire coral downwind there. So unless you're a really great kiteboarder and you have confidence in relaunching your kite, it's not necessarily somewhere where you want to kite. Kite Beach. Kite Beach is called Kite Beach because it's the best beach to kite on. And then a little further down, we have Playa Encuentra. That's our wave surfing spot. So all of these five beaches are within like less than 3 miles from each other, 10 minutes. So there's very few places in the world where you can have like five awesome kite beaches with five different conditions. What makes Cabarete unique? Okay, first thing, the water is always warm. It's always right about 80 degrees. I guess that's 70 or 27 degrees Celsius. It's that pretty blue Caribbean water that you think of when you think of the Caribbean. We're on the Atlantic, but we do have really nice blue water. We have all of our spots between them. We have flat water and waves. Not everywhere can you find nice flat water and also waves. When it pertains to the wind, we have 250 to 300 days per year of 15 to 25 knots. That means you can kite, 365 days a year. So almost every single day you can kite. And that's historically speaking for the wind statistics for the last 10 years. We already talked about the five main beaches within 5 minutes. And downwinder. So from any of those five beaches that I mentioned, you can launch easily and you can go downwind and get out easily. So if you want to go for a 2-hour downwinder or a 30-minute downwinder, you can just choose from whichever beach you want to launch and whichever beach you want to land at. We're going to start with Kite Beach because it's my favorite beach. It's where my kite school is and it's the Kite Beach. Although you can kite on all these other beaches, it's called Kite Beach for a reason. This is what our little bay looks like. So if you're looking to the right bottom of the screen, that's the point. And then all the way to the other little point, that's Kite Beach. And then this is my kiteboarding school. So you can see that's my deck. And I am taking this photo from my restaurant. And there's very few places where you're this close with restaurants and hotels to the action. You can see you're like 100 steps away from like being in the ocean, and you can sit here on our patio or any of the other patios on Kite Beach and watch all the action just right there. This is a drone shot I took. I have a drone, a little Mavic. Kite Beach is known for having like medium to little chop, but in the wintertime, it also has waves out there on the beach. That's one thing I wanted to show you. You can see where all these white, where the waves are, that's the reef. So you can have flat water on the inside where you see this green and blue kite. And then once you get out to the reef, there's waves. And that's just in one beach. So that's one of the unique characteristics of being on Kite Beach. Cabarete Bay is, like I said, where you're going to find, if you Google, it's going to show up as the center of town. It's great for kiteboarding also. Everything, just like Kite Beach, is located right on the beach, all the restaurants and the hotels. It has more space, which is why people tend to go there. Our bay is a little bit smaller. So if anybody likes Cabarete Bay as opposed to Kite Beach, it's because there's more space. To be frank, Kite Beach is a little bit smaller, but the conditions are better. So that's Cabarete Bay. The thing to know about Cabarete Bay is you'll have to share the water with windsurfers, which isn't necessarily a bad thing. It just means that you'll have to pay attention a little bit more to the right of ways because windsurfers are really picky about that. Not that you shouldn't be paying attention to your right of way sailing rules, to begin with, but you'll be sharing with some windsurfers and they get a little ornery if you don't practice the right-of-way rules. Then we have Encuentro. This is Jose Luis, my partner. This is the wave spot. So if you're into waves, it's really nice to like start off in Cabarete Bay or Kite Beach, do a nice downwinder down to Encuentro, smack the waves down there, and then get out and get a little, you can even just take a motorcycle ride back. It takes you like 2 minutes and 50 peso, which is the equivalent of $1. You'll just throw your kite gear on your, on the moto taxi and get back to your hotel really easily. More Shredding the Waves by Jose Luis. He started off as a freestyle rider, but now he's into the waves. There he is again. All of this is at Encuentro. Bozo Beach. So that was the beach that we talked about where, unless you're an advanced rider, you might not want to ride. So you can see up here in the top right-hand corner, that first little horseshoe is Cabarete Bay, and you can see all the kiteboarders and all the windsurfers in there, right? But then when you get to the second little horseshoe, there's nobody. And that's because this big brown spot towards the bottom middle of your screen is all fire coral. So if you end up crashing and heading downwind, you'll end up in this fire coral if you can't get your kite up fast enough. So that's just something to know. You'll have less people there, but you'll also have the quote-unquote danger of the fire coral. La Boca. Okay, so if you've ever watched any kiteboarding videos of pros in Cabarete, they've probably filmed in La Boca. So La Boca changes. It doesn't always look like this. The mouth, this is the river mouth, but there's also, if you headed off towards the right of this photo, it's mangroves on both sides and butter flat water. Usually this exits out into the ocean directly, but as I said, it's changing all the time with the tides and with storms and stuff like that. This is another spot that's not for beginners. It's mostly for pros, and that's because the mangroves will eat up your kite. If you drop your kite and you can't get it relaunched, it's going to end up in the mangroves, and that's not something that you want. Cabarete vibes and lifestyle. So I like kiteboarding. Everybody likes kiteboarding, potentially, who's here. But this is really, for me, what makes Cabarete special. The conditions are awesome. Almost everybody who kiteboards knows that we have some of the best conditions in the world. But one thing that is really important is how you feel when you're there. This is my kite school right here. That's how close the hotels are to the action. So yeah, like I said, you can just sit on the patio and watch the action, have a little drinky poo, and then go back out on the water and kite. This is one of my favorite photos from my restaurant because it encompasses like all the things that are Cabarete. There's lots of dogs. There's lots of digital nomads. Everybody likes to drink coffee. Dominican coffee is the best. And there's usually somebody doing a handstand or yoga somewhere. And this just goes to show how close you are to the ocean again. This is my patio. Dominicans. Dominicans are like the most fun people you're probably ever going to meet. And these are some of my favorite photos. This is Jose Luis getting a little piggyback ride back in. This is my friend Nisael. My friend Samuela and her boyfriend Joselito. Joselito works at my kite school. Jose Luis again doing some big air tricks out there. Yeah, so we get like 30 knots of wind sometimes. So like big air is making a comeback. So you'll see a lot of the guys. Just from like sitting right here on my patio, you're like watching a TV show of kiteboarding. And this is like the type of stuff you'll see. Cabarete is full of badass girls. I've been kiteboarding in a few spots around the world, and I've never seen as many girls who ride as hard as Cabarete. This is Kirsten. She's a champion kite foil racer. So you'll see that early in the morning. She's training for the Olympics also. It's my friend Swami. Kids, Cabarete is a really great place for kids. This is Jose Luis and his niece learning how to kiteboard. So you'll see tons of family, tons of kids here when you come. And that's my niece getting a ride along at one of the little kite retreats that I did. And then this is just showing you how young the Dominicans are when they learn how to kiteboard. I mean, this guy's like 6 or 7 years old and he's already doing like back rolls and stuff. It's pretty amazing.
Can you maybe, Tracy, tell us a little bit about the kiteboarding scene there? Like, I think you mentioned that you have seven or the most professionals from a single country, kids training from an early age.
And things like that. So the kids here start riding like really, really early. And the tourists, you know, they always feel like letting the kids ride their kites. And then the kite schools let the kids have some kites too. So they start riding when they're, you know, 6, 7, 8, 10 years old. We have 8 Dominican pros, and I'm not sure who has more pros than us, but trust me, 8 Dominican pros is a lot. So that ranges anywhere from freestyle to wave riding to now they're going into kite foil racing. So it's a big thing here. It's a major part of at least the Cabarete culture. It's not a big thing in the whole country and it's not respected enough by the Cabarete government. But as far as right here in Cabarete, they're starting them off pretty young and it's a big part of the culture here. Moving on to more culture, Spanish is the language, but you can get by with English. Exciting Caribbean vibe. So I've traveled to a lot of other Latino countries, Central America, and not only is this Latino, it's Caribbean. So it's that nice, exciting. I've been to like El Salvador and nothing against them. They're just a little bit more relaxed and laid back. Whereas like Dominicans are like very active. They talk loud. They use their hands a lot. It's just overall a really exciting, exciting culture. The locals are super friendly and it's a great place for families. So if you have kids and a wife or a husband who doesn't like to kiteboard or who isn't into kiteboarding yet, you can go kiteboarding and your wife or your husband who doesn't kiteboard and your kids are going to have just as good as of a time as you're having out there in the water. So this is my patio. These are a bunch of old school Dominican kiters and most of them are they teach at my school. So we hire only locals right now at my school. So that's also another really cool thing that I pride myself on is giving the locals jobs. These are two of my instructors. Flaco, he's everybody's favorite on the right, and then Joselito on the left. This is one of my favorite pictures of all time just because it shows like the carefree nature of Dominicans. It doesn't have much to do with kiteboarding. But it just goes to show you how much they care about their friends and their family. And no matter what, they're having a good time. Like they're just making the best of life, no matter what the situation is. And for me, this photo just like encompasses Dominican culture. So we already talked about Dominican pros. There's just pros hanging out everywhere, which is awesome. To the left, we have Luciano. He is a 4-time Master of the Ocean and one of the first Dominican pros. He used to travel around the world with Jose Luis. And in the middle, that's Ariel Corniel. If you're a kiteboarder, you probably know him. He's also been pretty famous in his day. He was the first Cabarete kiteboarder to win a competition, and he won it in Cabarete, so he's a pretty big deal. And then to the right is Alex Soto. He's Jose's cousin, and he has moved on to professional foil racing. He used to be really big into freestyle, and he was one of the like top, I don't know, I think top 5 in the world at some point, but now he's moved on to foil racing. We talked about it being really great for women. I throw women's camps. And so if you're a solo woman traveler, have no fear because you're safe and you have plenty of peers here. This is just also coming from my little women's camp that I have once a year. And then this is another one of my favorite photos. That's Flaco to the left. And I just would like to illustrate with this photo that no matter how old you are, you can learn how to kiteboard. So this guy's almost 80 years old on the right-hand side. And he learned how to kiteboard. I was so proud of him. His wife was there. She was taking photos. It was awesome. But also, like, I never knew when I took this photo how important it would be, like, in this day when we're talking about inclusion and, you know, everybody getting along. Like, for me, this photo just makes me want to cry.
It truly is a powerful photo, Tracy. It truly is.
Yeah, I love this photo. I'm so happy I have it. It's really great for my website and everything. I post it every so often. It gets a lot of likes. vibrant locals. Yeah. So, you know, when you're here, don't be afraid to make friends, because there's locals are super friendly. These two people on the right-hand side are famous because they've been like hanging out on the beach selling coconut and fruit for like 30 years. So when I post a photo of these guys on Facebook, it gets like 100 likes. It's the most ridiculous thing ever. Like, I can post a photo of somebody doing a double, like doing some big trick, but this gets 100 and maybe that other photo gets like 50 likes. Local cuisine. The food here is amazing and it's healthy, believe it or not. Seafood is big because it's fresh, but we also have tons of superfoods. Right now it's mango and avocado season, my favorite time of year. But yeah, there's just trees everywhere. You can just like, you'll find mangoes just like falling off the trees. And if you don't have a tree, like where you're staying, there's fruit stands everywhere and everything is really, really cheap. So it's very accessible. We have these stores called Calmados and they're like literally every 15 feet and it's cheap. So everything is accessible and inexpensive. It's really easy to stay healthy here. And that kind of goes along with like the yoga vibe that we also have. No wind, no problems. We have plenty of things to do here. So the tagline for the Dominican Republic advertising campaign is DR has it all, and they're not kidding. There's plenty of tours to do if you're into that sort of thing. If there's no wind, you can go on a tour. You can also take a half day tour, a 4-hour tour in the morning starting at 8. And our wind doesn't usually kick in until 2. So you could go do like a half day tour, come home, take a nap, eat some lunch, and then still like have plenty of time for kiteboarding. Because the wind starts blowing at 2:00 in the afternoon and then it doesn't stop blowing for the whole entire night. And now in the summertime, it gets dark at like 8:30, there's still light out. So you can go do a tour and then kite. We also have world-class stand-up paddle boarding on Kite Beach. This is in Cuentro Beach in the morning when there's no wind. We have waves 300 days a year. So you can surf in the morning, kite in the afternoon. Snorkeling and diving in those nice crystal clear waters. I think a lot of people don't know that we have mountains here. So like while you're out there kiteboarding, you're looking at mountains. The mountains, we have the highest point in the Caribbean, El Choco. That's the highest point in our Pico Duarte. It's the highest point in all of the Caribbean. And then this is my favorite little mountain view spot. I'm going to have a house right there one day. You can go horseback riding. There's all sorts of like hidden waterfalls. If you just drive anywhere, you're going to find like mountains and waterfalls, views everywhere. You can drive east or west for an hour or two and just get out wherever you feel like it and go, you know, walk off the side of the road. And this is what you're going to see on the entire North Coast. Yoga. You can do yoga at like 10 or 15 spots several times a day. And then if there's nothing else to do, you can just enjoy the sunset because we have like the most killer sunsets ever. Take your loved one, snuggle up, get you a little 2-for-1 drink for happy hour. Trip planning and logistics. So this is where we're gonna talk about the season and stuff like that. High season is winter. So when I say high season, I actually mean for tourists. So that means you're going to have to book early because winter tourists from Europe, not necessarily kiteboarders, and it's not necessarily the best wind, although we do have wind, they're booking Cabarete to escape the cold. And there is still kiteboarding, but you want to make sure that you book early if you're coming that time of year. Low season is summer through fall. And again, that's not to say that it's low wind season, it's low tourist season. But the best wind is from June, July, and August. So that's when we have the nice thermal consistent winds that kick up every day around 2:00 and blow 20 knots all day. My favorite month to be here is February and June. And that's because in February, most of the tourists are really, really hot and heavy here, December and January. And by February, they're starting to thin out. So there's less of a crowd. It's springtime, so the heat is starting to kick in, which means the thermal winds are starting to pick up. So sometimes you'll look out there, my birthday is February 15th, and I'll be the only one in 20 knots of wind on my 8-meter kite. And then June is another one of my favorite months because the real thermals are kicked in and there's really no tourist here in June, even though it's like the best months for wind. We have no tourists during that time, really. Flying in. Okay, this is important. I want you to pay attention. Puerto Plata is the closest airport. It's 20 minutes, but it might not be the cheapest airport. Okay. And you might not find a direct flight or a good flight flying into Puerto Plata. So the next best option is Santiago. It's only 1.5 hours away. It's a really nice scenic drive through the mountains, and it's $100. So sometimes the flight into Santiago can save you a couple $100, but then just add on $100 for a taxi ride, and it's a better flight maybe than you'll find in Puerto Plata. Whatever you do, don't fly into Punta Cana. It's 6 hours away. So a lot of times people confuse Punta Cana with Puerto Plata, and then they'll end up on a 3-day weekend having to drive 6 hours from Punta Cana. The flights there are way cheaper because of, we'll just say, like, politics. The government tries to drive everybody to Punta Cana for the all-inclusives. So the flights there are really, really cheap, but just don't get suckered into it. Try to fly into Puerto Plata or Santiago if you can. Plus the even though you'll save a couple $100, I think the taxi ride is $400 to get here from Punta Cana. While you're here, some things that people ask me a lot about are public transportation. It's cheap and easy. It'll cost you $1 US 50 pesos to get anywhere. So there's really no need to rent a car. And if you have your gear and you're like staying off the beaten path because you found somewhere cheap and cool, you can just throw your gear on the moto taxi and they'll drive you for $1. It's no big deal. The exchange rate right now is 58 Dominican pesos to $1 US, but most places will take dollars. So I suggest that you exchange money once you get here. But you can pay with dollars. You'll just get kind of ripped off a little bit on the exchange rate. Ripped off isn't a good word. You'll get a few points taken off for the exchange rate if you use dollars at the restaurant. And that's just for their trouble. Accommodation. You can live like a local or like a rock star. It's your choice. If you're going to be on the beach, you're probably going to pay a little bit more. That's just a given, right? But you can be 1 minute away from the beach and find a place for like $200 a month. You'll be living among the locals, but it's totally safe. And for 50 pesos a day, you can take public, or you can take a taxi, a moto taxi to the beach. Or if you're staying for a while, like if you're going to stay for a month, you can buy yourself your own little motorcycle for $250. It'll be a piece of crap, but then you can sell it for $250 when you leave. And everybody's always looking for a piece of crap moto here. So no loss there. Tipping, 10 to 20%. Everybody always wants to know if they should tip or not. So tipping is 10 to 20%. There's no real discussion there. Shopping is close. There's several grocery stores. There's liquor stores and churches on every corner, along with fruit stands and Kalmados. So you're going to find everything you need here. You don't need to stress about like, I need to bring my whole kitchen cabinet because we're going to be going to a developing country. Anything you need is here. This is just showing a photo of the accommodation. This little place is actually directly across the street from Kite Beach. So with 200 steps, you're in the ocean, but this is not oceanfront. But you can rent one of these little, it's called Mango House, just so you know. You can find it on Facebook under Mango House. It's a nice little commune, and all of the like local Dominican pros live in this little neighborhood right here. And tons of kiteboarders live here, lots of the instructors and stuff. So if you're looking for a nice little local place, you can rent one of these places for like $300 to $400 a month. And they have air conditioning. You just pay extra for the electricity. They're clean. They have everything you need. They're safe. And they're just steps from the ocean. Or you can be super fancy and live right on the beach. And this is what the accommodation looks like. So like I said, depending on how you want to live, you just pick it. And if you ever need help, you can always feel free to PM me. My goal in life is to make sure that people love Cabarete. Of course, I want to like make money, but I didn't buy the kite school to make money because frankly, it doesn't make a whole lot. I bought it because it gives me a platform to introduce people to Cabarete and to give locals a job. So always feel free to contact me for anything you need. Even if you don't need lessons, even if you're not going to stay in my accommodation, I'm always willing to help you figure out the perfect trip for you. And I don't need to get anything out of it except for just making sure that you have a nice trip and tell your friends about Cabarete. Okay. Another important part for the kiteboarders out there, the essential gear to bring on your kiteboarding trip. Summer, we already talked about, is 20 to 30 knots, thermal wind, flatter water, don't need a wetsuit. I'm 135 pounds. I'm American, so I don't really know what, you know, kilos are, sorry. But I ride an 8 meter all year round. If I can't ride my 8 meter, then I don't ride, but I'm spoiled. I get to ride 300 days a year. I just change my board. I either ride a twin tip or a directional. So it's very rare that I cannot be out on an 8 meter kite. In the wintertime, it's 12 to 25 knots. Storm wind, that just means it's more consistent. I mean, less consistent and more dense. It's a little bit more, so thermal winds are a lot more smooth, and then the storm winds are a little bit more gusty. But it's wave season, so if you're into waves, you want to be here in the wintertime because we get massive waves. You can ride double overhead waves here in the wintertime, no doubt. You can bring a shorty if you're cold natured, but you don't really need it. That's just like if you're wimpy like me. Sometimes I wear a shorty, but I've also been living in the Caribbean for 9 years, so I have a good excuse. Pack light because everything you need is here. Honestly, you can just bring your board bag and stuff your everything that you need in your board bag. There's no need to like go all out with luggage and bring 3 or 4 suitcases. Everything you need is here. Food, sunscreen, water, anything you need to get is here. Even if you need like special antibiotics, we don't, here you don't need a prescription. So like asthma medicine and antibiotics and mostly everything you can just get over the counter. So like you don't even have to worry about that. The only thing, oddly enough, that you should bring is a beach towel. I've been living here 9 years. I don't know where you can get a good beach towel. You can get a beach towel, one of those like skimpy, like little tourist towels at any of the shops here. But if you want like a nice beach towel, I suggest you bring your own beach towel because I have not been able to find one here. As crazy as it sounds, it's the only thing I suggest you bring. And let's see, it looks like we made it to the end. So if anybody has any questions, you can let me know. I'm going to turn off my screen sharing.
Tracy, thank you for this really beautiful story of Cabaret. We enjoyed it. I'm sorry we had some difficulties, but the story was out and we had all of the 50 people listen. So
yay!
Thanks for this. It truly is amazing. Everyone, I left a link in the chat where you can ask your questions to Tracy or just leave them in the chat and we'll go from there. One thing actually, Tracy, if I can start with my own question, I guess I'm the host, so I can, I can.
You can do that.
Yeah, I can do that. I actually got interested now, is there any, in general, like some special etiquette on how to behave on the beach? Because I see on many of the images, there is a lot of kiters and it seems there is various levels, like beginners and pros and everything. So maybe you can tell us a bit about that and how it looks like on a normal day.
Yeah, people would say it's crowded. So that's why I say in February and June are the best times to come because there's way less of a crowd. But yeah, anybody who already has taken kite lessons, they know how to behave on the beach. There's right of way rules. So if you're, you know, there's, if you have the upwind position, right hand forward, you have the right of way. If you are entering the water, you have the right of way. So there's rules that you learn, and I suggest that if you haven't done kiteboarding before, don't try it on your own, because it can be dangerous. And yes, you can wrap your lines with somebody, and you can walk into somebody on the beach or drop your kite on somebody by accident. So I suggest that you get kite lessons, and that's not just because I have a kite school, but because you will learn how to behave on the beach. And generally speaking, you need to be 50 meters away from the shore if you're going to be doing tricks, because that's where the beginners are. But again, all of that stuff, crowd control and right of way rules, are discussed in lessons. So I suggest everybody gets lessons just for their own safety and for the safety of others around them.
Well, that actually leads me to another question. It's basically a question we have two or three times on every webinar, and people are interested about the lessons. So how long does it take, how expensive they are? So maybe you can tell us a bit more for the people who want to learn kiteboarding and chose Cabarete to do so.
Yeah, so at our school, I think it's one of the less expensive places to learn in the world, just because the exchange rate is so great. But most people end up needing 9 hours of lessons, and that's an IKO standard. We're an IKO certified school, so we follow IKO standards. And just for those who don't know, that's like an international standard for kiteboarding. And our instructors are IKO certified. But yeah, generally speaking, most people need 9 hours. A 9-hour beginner course costs about $625. You'll end up taking 2 to 3 hours of lessons per day. And that just depends on your fitness level. And that brings me to the point, you do not have to be fit to kiteboard, because it doesn't take strong arms. It takes control, and that doesn't really take any strength. One thing that's going to happen to you is you're going to develop strength. You're going to get a really strong core, but you don't have to worry about having strong arms or having a strong core to start kiteboarding. As you saw, I had a guy that was almost 80 years old learning how to kiteboard, and we have kids, you know, they start as soon as they can fit in the kite gear and are mentally capable and mature enough to take lessons, which is usually around 11 or 13 years old.
And then for some experienced folk, can they also hire like a one-on-one lesson from one of the many pros inhabiting your school and beach and patio?
Yeah, so whenever you contact me for lessons, you just let me know what you want to do, when we always try to pair you with the person that's best for what you're trying to do. So we have wave surfing coaches, which is Jose Luis. He's one of the best you saw. He was on all the wave photos. And then his cousin, who is Alex Soto, he's one of the best foil instructors that I've ever met. So he's great for foiling lessons. If you want to learn how to do freestyle tricks, all I have to do is call up one of the guys and they'll come right over to our school. So we have everything you need right at our fingertips. WhatsApp is amazing. I can WhatsApp anything you need.
That's really cool. I guess, except a beach towel.
Yeah.
And,
right.
And that's exactly what John is asking in the chat. Like, he says that he's coming August 10th and asks if you want for him to pack a ton of beach towels for you.
Yeah, let's make a partnership, right? You bring him here from Costco, and I'll sell him at a 20% markup. 10 yeah. for you, 10 for me.
Yeah, and then we have a question that again is actually super relevant in these times. So can you address the COVID situation currently in Dominican Republic, and maybe some restrictions or rules that people coming to Cabaret need to know about and take care of?
So we have considerably, well, from what I understand, a low percentage, not a super low percentage, but relative to many places in the world, of COVID cases. In Cabarete specifically, we only had 3 cases that I've heard of, and nobody died from it. We have a fine medical system here. There's public hospitals, but there's also, you know, everybody accepts insurance here. I'm having my baby here, so if that lets you know how the medical system is, like, I'm staying here. I'm not going back to the United States. As far as the restrictions go, I don't think they just started allowing flights yesterday. I don't think they're making anybody quarantine as of now. That could change, obviously, because this is a changing thing every single day. And then if you're out on the streets and in public places, you have to socially distance and you have to wear a mask. It's mandatory. We just lifted our curfew. So we don't have a curfew anymore, but nothing is going to be allowed open past 8 p.m. unless it's an essential business. So bars, restaurants, nothing will be open from 8 p.m. until 5 p.m. in the morning as of right now. But to be honest, if you're out kiteboarding on the beach, obviously you don't need a mask. You just need to stay away from people and you're not going to be allowed to, you know, be super close to anybody in any of the restaurants. But I think that's the normal protocol for everywhere around the world. We are actually going to a meeting today at 4:30 with our Ministry of Tourism and Ministry of Health. All of the Cabarete community is going to discuss the protocols that we will have for teaching lessons.
But to sum it up, you can go to Cabarete. It's quite safe and you can operate, like your school can work.
As of now, yes. But, you know, I just want to make it clear that, like, the world is changing. Everything is changing. So as of right now, as of yesterday, we're open, flights are coming in, it's safe, we have a medical system, and most of the rules that you're experiencing probably in your country, we're experiencing here.
Cool, thanks for the update there. We have a question from Richard who is asking about the wind and weather in April, May, and September, October seasons.
Okay, so April and May honestly are not the best, and neither is September and November. those are, if I was gonna say it's the worst, that's the worst. But we do have wind during that time. It's just not every single day. So if you were talking, and sometimes, you know, to be honest, if you're talking about 250 to 300 days of wind per year in a 350 day year, sometimes we do have a week without wind, and it's usually in those times. More likely to have less wind around November because it's rainy season than April and May. This year, March, April, May, June, July, probably because everything had to be closed, we had wind every single day. Since the day we closed, middle of March, we've had wind blowing 20 knots every single day. So that's not the standard, but if you look at it historically speaking, April, May can be a little bit slower than June, July, and August and some other times of the year. November is the lowest of the low season. Everything's going to be super cheap. There's going to be a lot less people here. You'll get a less of the experience of the Cabarete vibe because there will be less people here. But if you're going to stay for a month, you're going to get plenty of wind and everything will be inexpensive. It just won't be the normal like summer crowd.
And Richard is thanking you for the answer.
You're welcome.
Good information to know. And then we also have a question from Jenny, is what time of the year is your women's camp and how many like women, or what? Maybe you can just tell us a bit more about your camp that you do for women.
Yeah, so we do. I have a friend, her name's Chrissy, and she owns a place called Grateful Yoga. And so we do a yoga and kite camp for women. I'm probably just going to open it up for everybody because, believe it or not, I had like guys wanting to come to the yoga and kiteboarding camp. So we'll see. And I might do two or three a year because the ones that I've done so far have done well. I have done them in the beginning of June because it's my favorite month. I know that there's going to be wind for the whole entire week because it's a week. And it's, you know, we do yoga twice a day. It includes all your food, all of your accommodation. And then we do, it's usually intermediate to advanced riding, not for straight up first time beginners. And you can just let us know in advance what you're looking to work on. And then we just make sure that we have that handled when you come for the camp. But the girls that we've had, they have thoroughly enjoyed it. And also we do all-inclusive packages that are not a camp, but it might as well be a camp for $11.99. So you can get accommodation for 7 days. You can get 6 days of food and 9 hours of beginner lessons for $11.99. So $1,200 and everything's included for a week.
Thanks. And for the women's cap, I don't know if I heard, like, is that for beginners only or?
No, or it's no? not for beginners. It's for intermediate to advanced. So it's for women who are looking to, once you're riding upwind, it's for people who are looking to do upwind and then anything after that, but it's not your standard 9 hours of beginner lessons.
Okay, thanks. And then one more thing that we had a question that's a bit unclear about diversity in Dominican Republic. So can you maybe just tell us a bit, because I know you told me when we were talking about this webinar that there is like young people, black people, women, all the everywhere. So can you just tell us a bit how those about these vibes in general on in Dominican Republic?
So one of my most favorite things about living here is that you're gonna meet up with people that in your other life you would never talk to, just because you might not have anything in common. One of the things that I say here is everybody's in board shorts, so everybody is approachable, and you don't know who's who, right? Because we're all wearing bikinis and board shorts. So everybody's on the same level. Everybody, you know, is here to kiteboard or here to like enjoy the Caribbean vibes. And from young to old, everybody is here, and it's safe and it's fun. The Dominicans, there's a lovely, lovely mix of locals and tourists and then immigrants. So I was telling you earlier today that like one of my favorite things about living here is we'll go out to dinner with, you know, 10 or 15 people, and there's 10 languages going on at one table, you know, and there's Dominicans and there's old people from Canada and there's young people who brought their kids all sitting at the same table and just like enjoying. Because if you ended up in Cabarete, you are special. Most people who look for anything in the Dominican Republic, they're going to end up in the all-inclusives in Punta Cana. But if you took the time to find Cabarete, you're different. And that's, I always say, the one thing that we all have in common is we're a little crazy. Because you have to be a little crazy to end up in Cabarete. Our age, our color, our languages, nothing else is the same. But we're a little bit crazy, a little bit wild to end up in Cabarete.
Cool. And that actually leads me to a question from, actually it's Ivan from Croatia. He is more interested in maybe your story. How did you give up this racer career that seems like if you have Ford attached to your name, it's not really so common that you remove it. It's usually the Ford who does it. So maybe you can just tell us a bit more like about what happened in those like a week or two that you kept vacation that made you stay?
Yeah, I was at the height of my career, but you know, honestly, I think people end up in places like this because they're ready for a change, whether they know it or not. And I was just ready for a change. It's a lot of pressure being a female in a mostly male dominated sport, which by the way, I'm a female in a male dominated thing now. But Cabarete just, you know, and now that I've been here 9 years, I can never go back. I just don't really have anything in common with the, if you can figure out, the Dominicans really have figured out how to respect their elders. They're still respecting their elders. They still value, I'm pregnant. They come get me out of the line and bring me to the front of the line. Like that doesn't happen in the United States. If I'm standing in the grocery store line, they come get you and bring you to the front of the line and nobody says anything about it. So they respect their elders. They love children. They're notoriously known for loving children. They have a thing for pregnant women. It's just, they value time over money. Of course, everybody wants money, but they have just really not lost. In my country and in my culture, we've lost respect for all of those things. Elders and children and pregnant women and time. And not everything is about money. And that's something that I learned here. It's like having a little bit more time and a lot more happiness is worth all the money in the world. And trust me, I know we all need money to survive. And I'm privileged being like a white American with an education. So I understand that. But yeah, that's what drew me to here is just the respect for things that my culture has lost.
Well, thank you for the answer. I think this is probably a perfect message to end this webinar. So I think we don't have any more questions. I don't know, Tracy, if you want to to have a final message for everyone who stayed. So we had almost 40 people stay until the end of the Q&A.
No, I just want to reiterate, if you need anything, get a hold of me, because I just want to help you have a good time in Cabarete. So whatever you're looking for in your vacation, whether you're a single person or coming with your family, you need lessons, you don't need lessons, you're a vegan, you're a meat eater, whatever it is, just let me know. And I've been here so long. And I just want you to love Cabarete. So I'm willing to help you out any way that I can. So just feel free to contact me, whether it's on Facebook or WhatsApp or whatever it is, and I'll help you plan your perfect vacation here.
Tracy, even a better end to the webinar. So thanks for this. Thank you for the great presentation and for your time and effort you put into this. Thanks everyone for staying and going through our technical difficulties as well, and for going to the Q&A and everything. Everyone will get a recording of the webinar, and everyone will also get contacts of Tracy, so you can email her if you need anything, and especially if you want to take on kiteboarding lessons in her school right in the center of Kite Beach. All right, thanks everyone, and I'll
just leave.
Bye.
Bye, thanks everyone, have a good day.
Bye everyone, thank you again, and see you in our next webinar in a week. We are doing Iceland hiking again, with more announcements coming up.
See you guys.
All right. Thank you, Tracy. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.